I wasn't given a title for my talk, so I thought I would call it Church Property, Blessing or Curse. I'm very grateful for the work the Global Institute for Church Management has done, and for the leadership of Pia and Father Bob. And I think the work of the Institute is very, very useful for the church. And of course, I'm very keen to see it continue and to prosper. I thank you for the invitation to address this useful meeting on the church and property. My contribution is described in the publications very grandly as a keynote address, but I feel it will be much more modest than that, something I would describe as being like an antipasto, an appetizer before the main courses are served. You have an impressive list of speakers, some academics with years of study as well as practical experience underlying their tasks. Now, with philosophy or history or theology, it might be different, but talking about property, everything I know has been learned on the job without any formal study. I think I might have had two or three classes in year nine on primitive bookkeeping or something like that. And I say to my sophisticated friends that I was very good at maths in grade six, and that it has stood me in good stead. What I learned from the business managers I worked with, principally, not entirely, and they were a succession of, I think, just about all lay people, highly competent, highly credentialed. And I learned from a few of the very senior board members I worked with. One man in particular was Sir Bernard Callanan. He was in the Second World War. He was in charge of the Australian troops and behind the lines in East Timor. They were the only group of Allied soldiers who were still fighting from Myanmar right down to the tip of Southeast Papua New Guinea. Very, very interesting, very, very interesting man, and I learned a lot from him. He was a sophisticated man, but not all of us are quite that. I'll tell you a little story. So what you're going to get are sort of a few thoughts from the Irish-Australian Catholic folklore on money and property. And as I said, not all of us were highly sophisticated. After the Second World War, I believe the national government made a completely informal approach to the Catholic authorities to see whether they would be interested in setting up what became the Australian National University. It's in Canberra. Canberra is the capital of Australia. It was set up because of the rivalry between the two great cities of Sydney and Melbourne. And on the first voting on federation, New South Wales voted against federation. Perhaps because it looked likely that the capital might be in Melbourne. So they were promised that the capital would be in New South Wales, and Melbourne insisted that it be at least 300 miles from Sydney. So the Australian Capital Territory was set up, and the Australian National University, which is highly rated now, it's a good research university, was set up. So anyhow, an approach was made. And in Canberra, there's no freehold land. All the land is owned by the government, and you're given very long leases, perhaps 100 years or so. And the approach was made, and the Monsignor said, "Now listen, the Catholic Church would not build a cowshed on land it did not own." And I have quoted that a number of times over the years, and I must say that's my starting position on that topic. Let me make some preliminary points. I believe strongly that certainly bishops, probably every parish priest and religious superiors must be able to understand the basic economic realities, especially about the institutes he's supervising. I say that bishops must be able to identify the holes in a ladder. And they must be able to remember from their experience the types of mishaps that have occurred and will continue to, could happen again. I was privileged to speak on a number of occasions at the courses held here in Rome, usually each year for the newly appointed bishops, the courses for the baby bishops. And this was one of the points I made to them. You must make it your business to ensure that you can understand the basics of what is happening economically. And I also used to make a second point, perhaps counterproductively. And I used to say this, I said, "Now, if any of you remain ignorant, if any of you don't understand money, for God's sake, don't tell people." Especially don't tell your staff or the people working with you. I remember on one occasion I was with quite a high level meeting with a senior church official who was genuinely committed to financial probity. And he began at the meeting by announcing that he didn't understand anything at all about these things. Now, I'm tempted to claim that I almost heard the sigh of relief from one or two crooks in the room. And when news of his comments would have percolated through the system, the malefactors would have been much encouraged. Second thing, church leaders need to have a basic understanding of finance and of the value of buildings and of the revenue which commercial land or buildings should return in order to avoid incompetence, a loss of remedies or opportunities, and prevent the ever-present possibility of corruption. Now, I am not suggesting that people should become like what the mythical Italian politician is supposed to have said, who urged his listeners to always think the worst of other people. He said it's sinful, but one will rarely be wrong. I could give you the name of the politician, but I won't. Now, I don't recount this terrible little anecdote to recommend its message, and I have explicitly decided to do otherwise for many decades. But incompetence and corruption do not always happen somewhere else. In one of my very first parishes, we discovered that a couple of the teenage altar servers had been systematically robbing the Sunday collection for weeks, if not for months or longer. Now, to my surprise, and was a genuine surprise, I learned here that Mother Teresa claimed that the two greatest dangers for clergy were sex and money. Not particularly, no enormous insight in that. But then she went and said that money was the worst of these two temptations. I've had to deal with a parish priest who wanted to sell his parish hall to a friend who was probably a criminal. He certainly had a colourful reputation, and he wanted to sell her for 20 or 30% below the estimated value. More innocently, there was another priest who was very interested in money matters, and he leased out the unused parish plant at a rate which enabled the leasee to sublet a portion and get a higher return than he was paying for the whole business. Thirdly, recently, after nearly 9 years' work, an Italian version of the new charter for the Roman Curia was released unexpectedly by Pope Francis. There might still be a little more polishing for the final official text with the vernacular translations is published. It's entitled Predicate Evangelium, Preach the Gospel, and even the most cynical observers concluded that the disasters had been avoided and that we had a solid but unadventurous and possibly unstylish document reflecting the Holy Father's priorities, the Dicastery for Evangelization, with the Pope himself as prefect, is at the top of the list, ahead of what was the Suprema, what used to be known as the Inquisition. Although I think technically now all the newly named dicasteries are equal. Now, paragraph 10 of Predicate Evangelium provoked a deal of speculation, some exaggerated, when it praised the gifts lay people can bring with their knowledge of family life, social reality, and of God's ways in the world. As missionary disciples, and because of their baptism, the role of the laity is inescapable. Their leadership roles and the lay exercise of governance are central. There was no restriction in the document of these roles to lay men, but there's no justification for thinking that a lay woman or a lay man might soon be head of the dicastery for the sacraments or appointing bishops or defending the purity of the faith, the apostolic tradition in the former Inquisition. However, it certainly means that there are no official barriers to the appointment of qualified lay experts, highly educated. Sometimes it could be with decades of experience in the financial world to manage the Vatican finances, the banks, the investments, and the property. As happens, I think, in nearly every Anglophone diocese throughout the world, nearly every one of them, I think, in my limited experience, is led by lay experts in that area. And that seems to me to be eminently sensible. So I have a dream of a time in the not too distant future when the Vatican financial authorities are acknowledged for their probity, their proper sense of Christian priorities, and for their competence. Where men and women who move through their ranks are well qualified by international standards and have a variety of experiences through secondment in other appropriate financial institutions. Most of these are likely to be lay people, although in particular clergy with particular skills or earlier careers in finance shouldn't by any manner of means be excluded. Now, this will mean extra cost for the Vatican, and imagination will be needed when transfers from one world to the other take place because of the spectacularly high salaries some enjoy in the secular world for finance, But it shouldn't, however, it shouldn't be impossible to find a balance of altruism, sacrifice, and appropriate rewards to introduce secular experience among the executives. And already in the Vatican, on the boards of Eeyore, the bank, and on the boards of the Council for the Economy, where most of the lay experts are very, very highly credentialed and experienced women of finance. So we already have high levels of expertise at that level of policy making. The Vatican financial authorities are certainly moving in the right direction. As I believe that corruption has been removed, although due mostly to COVID, the books are not yet balanced. The new mechanisms to control investment, improved investment, I don't think they're yet in place. In the new charter, Predicati Evangelium, the role and power of the Secretariat of State appears to have been reduced, as they no longer have control of substantial funds. I think this is a useful example of what we might describe as the separation of powers. I'm not sure it falls into that technical category, but that's the general idea. And it is an appropriate consequence for the huge financial loss on the London property. Another interesting example of this rebalancing, which will be contested in practice, I'm sure, is that the Secretariat for the Economy, rather than the Secretariat for State, now authorises the appointments to the Curia and the organisational chart of the whole organisation. I think that's Article 217.2. Although the Secretariat of State will continue to contribute to the discussions, Article 48. Traditionally, the final necessary approval of the Secretary of State over new appointment was justified by the need to ensure that only those of strong faith and good morals entered the Curia. But some felt that there were broader ambitions in play when that power was exercised. The new role of staff approval for the Secretariat of the Economy should throw extra light and emphasis on the importance of newcomers to the finance sections having previous financial experience, which was successful in both a monetary and moral terms. While it is some considerable time back that we're gazing, we are still in living memory. And it seemed that a history of economic failure in a diocese or a religious order was almost a prerequisite for appointment to the Curia. The Vatican should never become a home of last resort for clergy who have been less successful in the outside world. And I sometimes mutter, of course, only to myself and to a few friends, that our Lord only took the whip to the traders, the money changers and the temple, and to no one else. But these introductory remarks, setting the context for a more explicit discussion on church property, we should begin with a few, or I might begin with a few general points on the recent London property fiasco in Sloane Avenue, Chelsea, which was supervised by the Secretariat of State. As the court case in the Vatican is continuing on this issue, and indeed probably still in its early stages, only some general points can be made. While I want to strictly avoid assigning personal responsibility, guilt or innocence to particular persons. I think the first thing is to recognize that the Vatican lost a lot of money on this particular deal. Whether you're an old-fashioned fellow like me, but even a little bit more progressive, €217 million is a lot of money. And that is the amount that has been nominated by the prosecutor in the trial. Even if moral culpability cannot be proved among any of the Vatican personnel involved, responsibility for the incompetence must be acknowledged. Life shouldn't go on as before, as though nothing has changed. Even without the grave financial damage inflicted by COVID, no small organization such as the Vatican can afford such a huge loss. Coming on top of an annual pre-COVID deficit, a structural deficit, which is running at 20, 25 million euros a year, this is all public knowledge, and a looming deficit of hundreds of millions in the next day, in the next day, in the next decade for the pension fund. These are serious and inescapable challenges. This is the third major Vatican financial scandal in the last 40 years. In the 1980s, with the Banco Ambrosiano scandal involving the banker Angelo, I think, Sedona, and Roberto Calvi. Now, Calvi was alleged to have suicided under Blackfriars Bridge in the Thames River in London. He is alleged to have suicided while he had both hands tied behind his back. As a result of that incident, I think that my sum is correct, the Vatican was forced to pay out $230 million in 1980s values. Then, in the period of 2002 to 2007, we had the sale of SGIR and IOR properties for $59 million below market value. And only recently, at least former senior officials in the IOR, the bank, that's Angelo Caloia and Lamberto Luizzi, have been found guilty on these issues and sentenced to jail terms. As I just repeat, the Vatican authorities have now eliminated corruption. They've stopped the money laundering. With appropriate procedures and a modern chart of accounts, it's much more difficult to defraud. But as I said, the authorities have not yet taken effective steps to balance the yearly accounts, as will be patently clear when the COVID plague finishes. And just to restate the obvious, the Vatican can't afford any more huge financial disasters. The three incidents I mentioned, leaving aside adjusting the values from the 80s, you know, amount to a loss of half a billion, 500 million. And let me assure you, that's not all the story. Now, the second point to be made about the London property debacle is to realize that efficient, respected external auditors are not only appropriate, but extremely useful. And I, in fact, would say they're necessary. The external auditors, Pricewaterhouse and Coopers, and the Vatican Order, Libero Maloney, were removed in 2017. When they were attempting to examine the accounts of the Secretariat of State. And similarly, the Secretariat for the Economy was denied access to the Secretariat of State's financial records. As the Sloan Avenue project had begun, it seems around 2012, before the election of Pope Francis, and his sponsorship of the economic reforms, beginning with the excellent work done by the COSEA Committee of Inquiry, one cannot claim that the auditors would have prevented all the London losses. But at least the debacle which followed the attempted salvaging of the project by Tortsey would almost certainly have been less expensive. Another very basic point for all church property ventures is to avoid cooperating with banks and financial agents who have a well-established reputation for shadiness, especially when all the respectable banking institutions in the nation will refuse to deal with them, apart from us. This shouldn't need to be said, but it is a prudential option that has been avoided by the Vatican for 40 years at least, until recently. So I repeat, Sloane Avenue is a case study in how not to do things. The Catholic Church around the world has large land and property holdings. Professor Dan mentioned the church is the world's largest land holder. I had never considered this possibility, but I do acknowledge that it is appropriate for the church to own, as well as its churches, schools, hospitals, etc., property assets as part of its patrimony. All patrimony, including property patrimony, is essentially to be used for good Christian purposes. For example, service of the poor, education, health, and not primarily to grow the assets. There is no Christian virtue simply in having a larger patrimony, as the Christian attitude has changed from Jewish times so that possessions are no longer regarded as a sign of God's blessing. We therefore have the paradoxical situation where the poor and the poor in spirit are blessed, but a church which is genuinely poor doesn't have the capacity to help the poor and the down and out in any material sense. Margaret Thatcher used to love pointing out that if the Good Samaritan hadn't had some capital, he couldn't have left the money to pay for the fellow who was robbed and left on the side of the road. And that's correct. Money given by donors for specific purposes should be used for those purposes, or the donation refused. I just said to some donors yesterday, if you're going to give money for a specific purpose, see that it is used for that purpose. And so too, the source of income to increase the patrimony, for example, to purchase land or buildings, should be carefully considered. A case in point is the church use of Peter's Pence, which is primarily justified by the way the collection is explained to potential donors. Around 10 years ago, the Council of Cardinals for Supervising the Economic Affairs of the Vatican, we insisted that the publicity for Peter's Pence continue to make clear that the collection could be used to contribute to the running costs of the papal agencies, of the Curia, such as the Curia. But it's interesting that no cardinal then, I believe this is true, at least to my knowledge, imagined that substantial amounts from the Peter's Pence would be put into long-term property investments. And short-term investments in property should be very, very rare. And I don't think that money given for the poor, or what most of the donors think is destined for the poor, should be used for any investment purposes. Now, you might argue about that. My instinct is that money given for the poor should be used for that purpose as soon as possible, rather than in a dilatory fashion to enable the interest to accumulate. I chaired for quite some years an education committee back in Australia, which distributed government building funds for particular projects. And we prided ourselves on the speed in dispensing the money and on the comparatively small amount of interest which was allowed to accumulate. I've also worked on committees with a somewhat different approach. But what is of primary importance is that the donors, whether they be government, corporations, families, or individuals, know what is being done with the funds that they donate. All these people don't want the church to be buying at the top of the market, much less at the time of a property bubble, when the experts predicted there was a 90% chance that the property bubble would burst, which was the situation in London around 2016-2017, an entirely different issue from what's under public examination. I was completely unable to prevent a purchase at that particular time. Brexit came, 15% went out of the off the value, and the land and the property values in London, especially for the top of the market, also dropped a further 15%, possibly 30%. And as an old-fashioned person, I always like to know the owner of any property the church was buying. And I was always loath to embark on a deal when the ownership ran through a series of shelf companies, especially if they disappeared into the opaque waters of a tax haven. Just changing direction. When the going is good, leaders mustn't act and build as though such times will last forever. Farmers who survive in Australia realize that good seasons don't arrive every year. And farmers who do not act so carefully suffer and sometimes go broke. While property owners can finish up significantly overcapitalized with underused facilities or even struggling to pay for the maintenance of the very considerable facilities which they have, and as I said, unused. Budget provision for regular maintenance is essential for the health of the buildings. And in one or two mission countries which I visited, there was a fantastic resistance to doing regular maintenance, much less to setting aside a sum every year so that it could be dealt with methodically rather than just wait until the water was pouring through the roof. Church buildings in Australia are generally maintained well enough, helped by the levels of comparative prosperity. Declining populations in many country areas and declining rates of church practice are changing this. But just switching again, I always urge those building new churches, particularly in our expanding suburbs, to build well so that the churches would last for generations and generations. Not least because the future generations of believers might not have access to the levels of money which we have today. Rome is full of splendid ancient buildings whose interiors are regularly restored and changed, adapted across the decades. And I like this approach. Once in Siena, I was staying with a group in what had been an immense Carthusian complex of hermit residences. And my first instinct was to lament that this magnificent facility was no longer with the church. But the historical notes showed that the Carthusians had lived and prayed there for about 500 years. I thought, well, that's not bad going. Pretty good. That's no small achievement. Dioceses with large property portfolios need to identify accurately the nature and extent of their holdings, identifying those which are capable of producing commercial revenues, as distinct from historic buildings, for example, an old castle given by some countess, capable only of producing low returns. For years, if not decades, in the Vatican, this has proved to be a very difficult task. We even get a list of properties that was agreed between the Vatican and the Italian government as to what we owed. Large areas of land needn't remain vacant for generations in every circumstance. In Australia, and I believe in the UK, it is possible to sell long-term leases of land, for example, for 99 years, for property development, with the revenue for the extension of the leases to be paid, say, at least 25 years before they're due. So in Sydney, we have significant tracts of land given us by the colonial authorities, which we were quite unable to sell, but which we've leased for 99 years. Most cases, the land, when it was given well over 100 years ago, was in a bad situation. We've got a magnificent site for our cathedral, and it was on the side of a hill just outside the original capital. It was next to the jail and over the road from a racecourse. And now, of course, with modern technology, you've got a magnificent cathedral, which you can be built on the side of the hill, and so we have easy access to a crypt. We have other tranches of land, and it was originally given to us, and we were the buffer between the infectious diseases centre and the local the settlement in Manly. And of course, it's now fabulously valuable land. Now, for all entities likely to be in existence in 100 years' time, such as a diocese, this is a much more attractive proposition than selling the freehold land. And in countries where this capacity to lease for long term is not a legal possibility, then I think effort should be made to have the legislation changed so that it can become a possibility. Certainly some of the old families in London have used this for generations to maintain their wealth. Working with money can be seductive, and for clerics, I enjoyed the work. But finance officers should never have the last word in any church organisation. This should remain with the parish priest, the religious superior or bishop, because that's the way the organisations are set up, but to help ensure fidelity to the Christian and Catholic mission goals.
All right, thank you very much, Your Eminence. We have time for some Q&A.
My name is Ed Marion. I am from the large city of Michigan City, Indiana, which is close to Chicago. And you were talking about the debacle in London, of which I am not familiar. And I'm just wondering if you give some of the details of what was sold and what was actually it was sold for. I know you had said so many million dollars less than market value.
It's very complicated, and I probably couldn't give, it was going on for a long time. The Secretariat of State were involved, they were the agency. I don't think they had any authorization to do financial business. And I'm not sure, and I might be wrong, that they had even the capacity to own property in their own right. Now, if that might be inaccurate, but I'm inclined to think. So the building was bought in partnership. I think it originally started off as a proposal to develop an oil field in Angola, and somebody very sensibly warned them off that. Then it moved to this partnership in London, and the money was also, Vatican money was also invested in some other, in I think in the companies of the partner. And then it was felt that the partner was unresponsive to Vatican directions, and so they decided to try to buy him out. And what had happened is, in the interim, I say all this, and my facts might slightly be wrong, so with a bit of a caveat, but I think there'd been a great upsurge in London property values. Simultaneously, it went on for 5 or 6 or 7 years, the process. And they needed more money. They needed something like 200 million to salvage the deal, to get complete control. They asked EOR, which is the so-called Vatican Bank. It's not technically the Vatican Bank. And the EOR said, well, we would like to know what's going on. And eventually they said, there's something funny here. And they referred it to the IFE, the money laundering. So this gentleman, Tortsi, came in to help. And he was going to, and I think, gain control of the project. And it's there quite clearly in the contract. The Vatican bought, say, 30,000 shares off him. It's in the contract. But it is also in the contract quite explicitly that they were not buying 1,000 shares, and that 1,000 shares had all the rights, all the decision-making, all the power of deciding. And so it's there in the... It's not as though it's hidden, and it was accepted. And then when they realized the consequences of that, of course, they tried to buy those 1,000 shares. And whether it was 20 million or 30 million or 15 million or 10 million, that was one of the issues that were discovered. So that were debated. So that's as good as I can do with telling the story.
Thank you. Father Bob Gall had his hand up. Thanks. And I should also take this opportunity. Father Bob Gall is the director of the program of church management at the Pontifical University of the Holy Cross, and he's been with the program since the beginning. And we will have brochures and information out there if you'd like more information. Father Bob, your question.
Thank you, Pia. Thank you, Your Eminence, for the wonderful presentation. That's it's certainly inspiring, and so many stories that are also informative and educational. You mentioned, for instance, the story of your own formation at the Urban College and the role of managing those books, the books of for the book sales, and how it the impact, I think, even upon yourself and your own formation. In terms of, you know, currently the formation for the priesthood, there's really no plan for studies that involve these technical skills. And what we found in the program of church management is that through the application process for our students, there's an awakening of real interest, and that they see this as crucial for evangelization. I'm wondering if you could expand a bit upon the role of this formation for priests, and I suppose also for bishops, and how it can be integrated within their spiritual formation, that it really is for the salvation of their souls too. Thank you.
I can't go on at any considerable length about that, except that I'm clear that something must be done, should be done. We certainly have started. We'll have to be careful, of course, that some of the bishops and priests don't become too keen on it. Because, you see, it is much easier to run the money than to convert someone. I was giving a talk at the Comunione Liberazione meeting for the youth up in Rimini. And I said, it is much harder to convert someone than to reform the Vatican finances. And the secular press quoted me as saying exactly the opposite. And I put out a corrective, but they still didn't particularly take it up. They just couldn't hear. They probably thought he's got it wrong. you know, the idea that, well, I suppose anybody be interested in conversion, and that it was more difficult to do that than to get on top of the Vatican finances, which is not easy. So, but it should be done.
Thank you.
Good morning, Cardinal Pell, and thank you very much for your very insightful comments. I work with a lot of churches in disenfranchised and lower income communities across the United States. And obviously the Catholic Church has a great
presence. Could you introduce yourself?
Oh, and sorry, Charles King, from Washington, D.C. in the United States. What is your view about the Catholic Church? As you said, the church should be used in church properties to do good works in performing collaborations with possibly non-Catholic entities that are also doing good works. And because you have the availability of the spaces and the properties in the right place to serve these underserved, disenfranchised people, do you see that as a possibility to do more of that sort of collaboration using your facilities to help these people?
Well, I can only give a personal opinion, and I would massively endorse those possibilities. For 9 years, I was chairman of our Caritas, this in Australia, the Overseas Development and Relief Organization. And we had a commitment to partnership, so in which we just didn't give out money, but we got the more or less insisted that the locals had a big say in what the money was spent on, and then in organizing it and spending it. Now, I think Obama started off his working career in such a joint organization like that. I'm completely open to such good possibilities.
Thank you, Your Eminence. I'm Michael Pacheros from the Archdiocese of Malta. You briefly mentioned Peter Spence. What's your personal estimate of the money collected which actually goes towards the needy and towards the poor? Because this is something which even donors would love to actually know how many people are being helped by the Universal Church. I believe that money which is given to a particular cause, as you say, there should be no exceptions to that. So what are your comments on that? Thank you.
It's a vexed question. It varies from year to year, and you just have to see. Now, I went to bat very strongly for what I thought was a minimalist position. I was mildly embarrassed by it. But I said at least half the money should go to the poor. Now, I thought that was a bit mealy-mouthed on mine, but I was battling to achieve that. And in some years, I didn't. I totally agree with you. I mean, if money's given to help run the show, good, we need it. We can't run on Hail Marys or fresh air. But if money is given for the poor and the battling, it should go to the poor and the battling. I'm quite clear about that.
Natalie Gray is my name. I'm from Melbourne, and I'm here with the Carmelites for Q. Mm-hmm. And we're here to assist in the transfer of stewardship of their monastery in Morocco to hopefully Siena College in Camberwell. And my question goes to the issue of evangelism. And we've talked about the properties, and we've talked about the governance, which is terrific, and finding good end uses for the money and the properties. But I'd appreciate some thoughts on the concept of evangelism, like you were talking about with the McKinsey crowd, in actually the process of the change, that in fact the way we deal with people in what are very hard visible circumstances are ways that in a soft way we can actually promote that the church is doing good and are good to deal with. And particularly in your talk, when you spoke about people who are scared about the process that are involved in, don't have a clear understanding, but a lot of responsibility. the tendency to posture in order to give themselves time and to have power, rather than to say, how can we work together to move forward in a way that strengthens the church overall?
Well, there are lots of things that I might say. We weren't trying to evangelize these young McKinsey kids in any shape or form. As I said, my fear was completely the opposite, that we would scandalize them. And I suppose the only thing, they had a very sympathetic high executive who chose them. And the only interest thing that our first thing was to that they'd be competent, and they were, and they would work, they could, and they did work morning, noon, and night. Not everybody else in the Vatican worked those hours. as I said, overwhelmingly, they were very proud to have done it. And some of them, even one of the fellows who worked with us for 6 months or 12 months, he even flew out from Germany to see me when I was in jail. Which I was enormously grateful. Now, if people are a bit uncertain, there's no point in browbeating them and rebuking them for being uncertain. You've got to build up their confidence and reassure them and get trust and try to explain where we are. And of course, in some circumstances, say where the Catholics are a very small minority, the task of evangelism is quite different from what it might be in Malta or Poland. I've heard of one Asian country where many of the priests will not mention Christ or preach Christ at all. I'm not in favor of that at all. But we can do many things where we don't have to be preaching every day of the week. And cooperation is the way forward.
Thank you, Eminence. I'm Reverend Father Andrew Hassan Kamara from Sierra Leone, a fourth edition student of PCM. As you said, it is difficult to balance the books. It's also, for me, very much difficult for us in the diocesan level for financial teams to balance the yearly books also. I just want to know whether these reforms that are taking place in the Vatican, if there are any plans or there is any team ever that existed that is also in an auditing system to audit dioceses of the world. Because I have never seen a team in my diocese that this is an auditing team, because I am seeing that we are really afraid of auditing.
Yes,
internally and also externally.
One of the things I have pushed for with, a spectacular lack of success, and I said this to the baby bishops, I said I would like a system whereby every bishop who is starting in a diocese institutes an audit of what happened before. I said it would have the great advantage so that the new bishop would know actually where he was starting. Now, there was enormous resistance to that. And resistance took different forms in different countries. Some people said that they certainly wouldn't entrust that to secular firms, because it might be taken over by the government or run by the secular opponents of the church, and I can understand that. One possibility that was canvassed was that, for example, in a region or in an archdiocese, there would be competent, independent auditors perhaps sponsored by the local conference of bishops, perhaps by the archbishop, the Catholics, and they would go and do the audit. People are frightened, you're quite right, but I do think with the help of people like yourself on the ground, we need to explain it's in everybody's long-term interests. And, and you might even say, well, look, we're not interested in throwing 55 people into jail, but we are interested in identifying whether there are still people in the system who are systematically taking a cut. I said, there's a bit of a difficulty. It can be like mowing the lawn, where you cut off all the top of the lawn, but the roots, they go underground and the roots are still there, and they just lay low and they wait to reemerge in more congenial times. But I think it is one of the things we experienced here was, look, it's just you Anglos trying to take over, you white English speakers trying to impose on the rest of the world the way things are done in your... Now, I don't think that's accurate. We always said, look, we were just trying to impose what is universally accepted as the best practice in finance. We had some two little anecdotes. We found that the Vatican departments had 1.3 or 1.4 billion stuck away in their drawers for a rainy day, which wasn't on their books. It wasn't, I don't think it was being robbed or anything like that. And we just said, no, that's got to be on your books, even if it is just there for a rainy day. And then we had marvelous interchanges at the staff when it was explained to the staff what we were doing. And, you know, people would stand up and say, are you saying to us that we've got to account for what happens with our cash? But you've got to account for the cash too. And we say, yeah.
If I could just add to that too, Father Andrew, one of the students, one of your colleagues, previous alumni, Eric from Pakistan, he's come for the executive sessions, and he runs a Catholic hospital in Pakistan. And so they did an audit, and when they did the audit, they found out that a tubal ligation had taken place and it had been performed by a Muslim doctor using the hospital. The audit is what helped them to align to their mission. So part of it is also it's how we look at it. The audit can actually be a way of helping the organization to mission align. We have a question online, right, David?
Ian Storer from Oakland, California. I'm the founder and CEO of this space, a tech startup helping churches with renting their space out and making it usable in the community. You mentioned legislation and changing that where needed, and it made me think of legislation and taxation, which are often topics that churches shy away from. And as soon as the concept of anything that might be taxable comes up, people run away. I wonder if you could comment on where you see lines or things that should be reconsidered in terms of how we deal with legislation, taxation, and in terms of the operations of the church in certain circumstances.
No, I couldn't say anything useful on that. One, because I'm pretty ignorant, and second, because the situation is so different in different countries. But one of the wonderful things about the church is that at every level that I have worked, parish, diocese, nationally, internationally, there are always enormously competent, good lay financial people who are willing to help. Now, one or two of them once in a while might want to use that for their advantage, but overwhelmingly, that's not the case. So if I could just go back to this question of auditing and that. I had a number of visits from a very senior fellow from a very large country in the third world, who was enormously concerned about financial irregularities in the church and was having terrible difficulty in getting anybody to take any action at all. So you fellas who probably will eventually be, running things, don't be one of those. Some people are experts at not knowing. Don't be one of those. Now, you know, you don't have to bring the house down on yourself all the time, but you know, if there are big problems, and if it proves, once you have a bit of a look yourself, that yes, they are pretty significant, you know, you've got to at least start to address them in some way or other. Well, first of all, if there's questions of right and wrong, but then secondly, questions of prudence for the organization.
Excuse me. We have a question online from Claire, who's at the Religious News Service. She says, Pope Francis has centralized a great deal of the Vatican's financials and real estate management within the Administration for the Patrimony of the Holy See, or APSA. For many, APSA remains a black box with limited transparency. What are your considerations on APSA's strengthened role at the Vatican?
Oh, that's a very good question. I think it's very, very important that the leadership at the Vatican, especially the new proposals to control investment, are efficient and fundamentally transparent, so that we can know pretty basically what is going on in APSA, and that it is okay. It's a we've made very significant progress, and I'm too far removed. I'm out of it too long, but you know, given my ignorance, I couldn't say that we've completely spring cleaned. But I think the people running the show are people of integrity, and we wish them well. And it's very important, of course, that that it's done well. There's no great virtue in just transferring the responsibility unless the performance is significantly improved. And we want improved performance. We can't afford to lose another 500 million through incompetence or corruption in the next 40 years.
So before we go to our last question, I wanted to add, Global Institute actually worked with APSA to translate into English their first ever consolidated financial report that came out last year. It came out in Italian, so we worked with a lot of experts, and APSA approved the final English translation, and we have that on our website at gicm.org. And last question is from Dan Kelly.
Thanks. And Dan Kelly, Notre Dame, Indiana, the Fitzgerald Institute. Thank you so much, Cardinal Pell, for the presentation. I want to come back to an issue that you mentioned in your presentation in terms of the use of lay experts. It also intersects with Father Bob's question about sort of training of clergy and religious in financial and real estate matters. And I guess the way I would set it up is, you had mentioned separation of powers in your talk. Another concept that kind of occurred to me is the idea, at least in economics, there's this idea of theory of the firm. And sort of the idea is, well, there's certain activities that should, maybe if you're running a business, should take place inside the firm that are best done by employees of the firm. And there's certain activities that it might be wise to contract outside the firm because somebody else has expertise. And so there's a whole literature about how do you draw that line and what determines what firms do internally versus externally. It strikes me that there's a sort of an analog for the church. Although here, I think all of your questions have identified maybe three possibilities. One, obviously, the people running the show, the pastors, the religious leaders, and obviously it would be good to have more training in real estate and finance for them. Another group that you talked about, lay experts, Catholic or otherwise, who could help internally with the church, and especially if they're mission aligned, especially if they have deep expertise, this is what they do for a living. And then a third group might even be individuals, organizations who are not working inside of the church, lay or clergy, but that we look to as experts or partners on a deal. So, you know, whether it's McKinsey or a real estate firm like CBRE who might be involved. So I wonder if you, and I think all three of those we should be doing more of. We should be, you know, helping to train clergy more on real estate and financial issues. We should be getting more lay Catholics involved who have expertise, and we should be more willing, again, like you said, we don't want to hire the crooks, but to hire sort of people who are trusted outside partners. I wonder if you have any thoughts, and maybe this is the theme for the whole rest of the conference as well, but if you have any thoughts of how the church should think about that issue in terms of dividing who does what?
That's a big question. I could only make one or two preliminary comments. But the first thing we Anglos need to recognize is not all the world thinks the way we do. There are often quite different casts of minds, quite different approaches. And sometimes people are quite opposed to us and quite suspicious of us simply because of what we are, quite independent of what we might be doing. People are different, nations are different, styles are different, and we've got to evaluate well in those differences. So I remember as chairman of Caritas, I eventually became quite clear. I believed in local control, local choice of the projects, local running the project. But whatever your culture was, we wanted to know where the money went. And if people weren't cooperative, I said, well, the answer is always very simple. The next year's donation doesn't come. I'm rambling on, but one other example, say with the opposition to international auditors here in the Vatican, you know, people ran the line, the Vatican is a nation state, and you know, nation states are not audited by external companies. Now, in fact, from examining what happens in Australia and the States, and we modeled ourselves a lot on Singapore, that's not the case. But, you know, people feel, a big international company based in the English-speaking world, probably hand in hand with the CIA, and they'll be finding out what we're doing. It wouldn't matter much, I think, whether they did, but that's another issue. And your auditors need to be independent, though. If, for example, you've got an outside auditor and 80% of his business is with you, he's not going to be wanting to upset you. You need independent and competent auditors, and they're not infallible. Only the Pope, under very limited conditions, is infallible. Auditors aren't, as we know. So apart from those preliminary ramblings, I don't have anything much sensible to say. But all the sort of things you're mentioning are important.
Great. Thank you, Your Eminence. Pull this out. Well, I thank His Eminence for his expertise, but most importantly for your witness, both professionally and personally in living out transparency and accountability. I think we're one, we're unanimous here that you continue to inspire us. And we thank you for that ongoing witness. So thank you very, very much.